Have you been in a grocery store lately? And while you're looking for things, you keep getting hit with the word protein. And you see this on cereals, soups, snacks, bottled water. Seriously, bottled water. Okay, don't we get enough protein in our diets every day? Okay, well, from the Food and Agriculture Organization, they've done sort of this US look, global look. And in North America, we eat more meat than almost any other region in the country. And the US Department of Agriculture says Americans eat on average 222 pounds of meat a year. How did we get here? Oh my God. Okay. So if you look at the rest of the world, many populations get most of their protein from plant sources and they don't have protein deficiency. In fact, many of those plant-based populations are thriving. So how did we get so bizarrely hooked up with meat? And does more meat really mean better health and more strength? Well, I am here to help. I am Christopher Gardner, nutrition scientist, professor of medicine at Stanford University, where for the last 30 years, I've unraveled nutrition mysteries and conducted over 24 human nutrition intervention trials, published over 150 research papers. And today I'm here to talk to you about what I think a lot of people get wrong, protein. So let's start with facts. Where do we come up with how much you need? So the National Academies is responsible for this, and they do our recommended dietary allowance, which for protein is 0.36 grams of protein per pound of body weight. And for a healthy adult, that might be 50 or 60 grams. Now, how would that compare with how much Americans eat? And we know that from the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey. Take a look at the numbers. Isn't it about double? Okay, but there's a really interesting sideline here, which is the RDA is set with a safety buffer. So actual requirements on average are lower than the RDA. So most people need less than the RDA. So now compare average requirement to typical intake in the US, and it's about double, right? You see that, huh? Okay, so let's say we're getting a lot of protein in our diet and a lot more than we need. What happens to the extra? Does the extra make us extra strong? Do we get extra muscle? Not so much. Our bodies don't treat protein the same way it treats fats and carbs. So once we've used the protein we've got today for its needs, so we're doing muscle maintenance, enzymes, hormones, the rest, excess protein, is broken down. And there's no place to store it. So when we're breaking it down, we have to take the nitrogen, turn it into ammonia. The kidneys have to work to excrete it, and the rest gets turned to carbohydrate and fat. You can't just eat more protein and be stronger. You actually are making your body work harder to get rid of it at that point. Published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, eating more protein was not associated with increase in muscle mass unless it was accompanied by rigorous resistance training. And most of us aren't trying to build muscle, we're just trying to maintain it. So I think we're going to be okay. Let's zoom out from us and think about the planet a little here. So in 2019, 37 scientists from 16 different countries put together the Eat Lancet report. Landmark study, critical question that they were asking was, how are we going to feed a growing global population in a way that will benefit both human health and the health of the planet? And the finding was dire. We are eating meat at levels that are not sustainable. So you could look to the FAO that shows that the livestock industry is responsible for about 15% of global greenhouse gas emissions, and that's more than the whole transportation sector. You could look at how much water it takes to produce 1 pound of beef, and it's about 1,800 gallons. So the solution here is to make a shift in our diet. And so the Eat Lancet conclusion was we should be getting about 80% of our calories from plants. Okay, if we cut back on the meat and we ate more plants, we could reduce our carbon footprint, we could conserve some of the agricultural land and water resources, and we would promote biodiversity. But I assume some of you are in the room are thinking, wait a sec, all those plants? Ah, where am I going to get my protein? Isn't there something about plant protein being inferior, or meat has complete protein? So In 2019, my colleagues and I published a paper looking at amino acids in different kind of foods. And I've made a graph for you here. It's mostly just colors. It's okay if you can't see the small print. This is the distribution of amino acids in different proportions for five different kinds of animal source foods. And hopefully you'll conclude that pretty similar proportions across the line. Okay, now try to imagine what the profile would look like for plant proteins, right? How weirdly, bizarrely different would that be for plants? They are, right? They're missing amino acids. How many of you heard that thing about quinoa? The only plant food with all nine essential amino acids. Okay, BS. I call BS. Look at this profile. I'm going to assume some of you are bewildered and maybe even feel like you were deceived or lied to. All plant foods have all 20 amino acids. The proportions are not identical, and truly, the proportions in animal foods are optimal, but they're really not that different. If you eat a variety of foods, it wouldn't be that hard to get all the protein that you needed. Now, you might have another question is, wait a sec, those are proportions. What about amounts of protein? So it's true, for the same number of calories, animal foods would have more protein. But do you really need more or do you need enough? So I tried to make a quick example for you, and I took beans, nuts, grains, soy milk, and broccoli. I just picked five, and I hope you can read that and that it's reasonable portions. And that group of five would provide 900 calories and 50 grams of plant protein. Okay, but you don't eat 900 calories a day. You eat 2 or 3,000 calories a day. So imagine eating the rest. Imagining it was all plants. I showed you all the plants have all the amino acids. You get more protein than that. Or if you have mixtures of plant and animal, that's how you'd get up to 100 grams of protein a day. Okay, now part of the kicker here in addition to this is that plants have fewer calories, which could help some people who are trying to maintain their weight. And plants have low saturated fat, no cholesterol, and fiber. Americans eat about half the recommendation for fiber. Okay, animal foods have no fiber and are often loaded with saturated fat and cholesterol. So a research paper published in JAMA Internal Medicine suggested that if you replaced animal protein with plant protein, the risk of early death would go down by 24%. Now, isn't this a longevity conference? Okay, so if early death decreased, wouldn't that be good for longevity? I think so. How about flavor? You're probably thinking, okay, they're healthy, but do vegetables taste good? Yes, yes. Vegetables can be unapologetically delicious. There are now chefs around the world perfecting their plant-forward menus with all kinds of flavor profiles from cuisines in the Middle East, the Mediterranean, Asia, Africa, Latin America, India. There are a lot of great plant diets out there. I tend to work most directly with the Culinary Institute of America. That would be the other CIA. And they have embraced an initiative of the protein flip. So here's what that looks like. Picture the typical American plate with meat front and center and the plants on the side. And the protein flip means you'd put the plants at the center of the plate, make them the stars, take advantage of this global fusion of flavors, and relegate meat to a supporting role. It would be a condiment, it would be on the side, or just be smaller portions. We're talking salads, tacos, stir fry, pasta. And so this, I hope, this allows you to think that plant-based meats can be as indulgent and satisfying as meats. I go to their conferences all the time. Oh, their food just blows my socks off. And we have been studying this. Recently, we got identical twins, and we randomized half of them to a vegan diet and half of them to an omnivorous diet. And within 8 weeks, the group that went vegan had better cardiometabolic risk factors, a healthier microbiome, and lower markers of aging. Is this a longevity conference? Yes, actually, their telomeres were better and their epigenetic biological clocks were better. And so this shows in this experiment that plant-based diet can be healthy for humans, and those choices would have been good for the planet as well. So, where does this leave us? Where does this leave you? You don't have to be a full-blown vegan to make a difference. Small, sustainable changes can be important for positive impact. You could try to take a few animal-based meals a week and turn them into plant-based meals. You could try new recipes. You could do lentil soup, veggie tacos, quinoa salad. But here's the take-home message for now. Stop obsessing about protein. Eat more plants. It's not how much you get. It's where you get it from. And plants offer more than enough to help you lead a healthy and strong life. I can think of plenty of examples of really large, strong creatures that don't obsess about protein and don't eat any meat. I even know a bunch of big, strong, healthy human herbivores. In a world that's constantly chasing more protein, more health, more vitality, maybe sometimes the answer should be not to add, but to shift. So shifting to eating more plants would not only benefit you, but the planet, future generations, and even the animals that we share this world with. You don't have to be perfect, but we could be better one plant-based meal at a time. Each small choice ripples outward to help build a healthier and sustainable planet. And the good news is, this journey isn't just good for you, but it can be unapologetically delicious. Thanks.